Okay, party people, this is Michaela Berti speaking. Welcome to the new game of the day. Another Sicilian defense game in our series about the Sicilian defense. This one was played against Stein with the white pieces playing against Portisch. Stein was a very, very, very strong grandmaster in the 60s. He died very young, I guess in the 70s. One of the best tacticians of his generation. And Portisch was a very strong Hungarian grandmaster. He played, I guess, up to the 80s. Very classical player, very solid player. So this is will be very interesting to see someone who's really good at attacking, and then somebody who is a very solid player. Both going for the Sicilian. Okay, let's see what happens. Stein, white, open d4, c5. You see here the so-called Porzen system after a6. Yeah, I mean, it's you don't see it that often in tournament, but okay. White just simply develops, playing bishop to d3. Black plays f6, and white here castles short. I mean, if you don't play the Sicilian that often and with white, and you don't want to go in all those crazy variations that you get if you castle long, you can always play this setup. You know, just play bishop d3, castle short, and you take out all of basically 90% of Black's ideas in the Sicilian. And I think this this game is a good example for this. Black plays the queen to the best square here, plays queen to c7. And white just develops very calmly. He plays knight to d2. There's no reason to rush anything. Okay. White black plays knight to c6. White captured it. B to c6, and white plays f4. This is also a good strategy. I mean, now you are better developed, and basically all of your pieces are gunning down here on the king side, so you attack on the king side. Black played bishop to c4, developing with a tempo, and the king goes to the corner, king h1, and here black played d6. And Stein played his knight to the better square to f3. And I mean, here white has a slight advantage, and I would say that his position is a little bit easier to play. Black here plays the right move. He played e5 to get something going in the center. And to open up here this line, you want to develop, you want to create space for your pieces. And white here took. We see an exchange on e5. And white here played the good move knight to h4. The idea is that he wants to put his knight on f5. Which is always means trouble for the black king if you can put a piece there. And I mean, in this kind of position where all of your pieces are aiming at the king side, you have to attack on the king side. The problem here was that Stein had to calculate the move knight to g4, and this is not easy to calculate, because the threat here is that he plays his knight to f2, then you basically have to give up the exchange, and then you have to prove that your attack is strong enough. And here Stein had prepared this variation. He wanted to play his queen to f3. Black plays queen to a7 with the idea to reinforcing his threat on f2. Basically, with f3, white avoided the immediate knight to f2, but with the queen to a7, now the threat is again there, it's a renewed mood. So what are you doing against it? Well, you just ignore it and you play your knight to f5, because now even if you recapture, you recapture with the pawn, and if black now plays the idea, you capture, you sacrifice the exchange, and you play f6, and this is all basically game over. The problem is that this pawn is hanging, and as this pawn is hanging now, and let's say okay, you want to protect c6, so you play rook to c8, then you capture, and what do you do with this pawn? I mean, if you try to somehow attack it, and then comes queen to f5, and this is again very, very big problem, because this is a double threat. You're attacking this rook and this pawn here, so only move, and now you just take the minor piece, the bishop on f2, and you have the bishop pair against the rook. Your king is safe, and you can attack all those weak pawns here. So this is clearly winning for white. Let's say that you try after f6, you ignore the threat on c6 and you play g6. Then you take. King has to go basically here in the corner, and this is horrible to play. This is completely lost for black. White can here take the rook. He can play his bishop here, his rook to e1, and capture here. This is completely lost for black. So it was a good decision by black not to play his bishop, his knight, pardon me, to g4. Instead, he calmly castled. Again, Portage was a very solid player. You can see it here. But the problem is now white has knight to f5, and he could have taken here. Taking here would have been equal, but he played bishop e6, and this is still okay. White plays his bishop to c4. This is okay. The problem is this move here, where he plays his knight to b6. I mean, basically every other move would have been better. He could have here captured here. The problem is that after this move, Stein, the tactician, played knight capturing the pawn on g7, and this is something that that Portage missed, because now you first of all, you cannot take the knight here. If you take it, the problem is that white has this move. Now, if you go back, this is a mate in 4, and no matter what you try, this is just mate. And okay, let's look at the king going to wait a minute, the king going to g6. This is also mate. You just capture here. You play basically the same idea, queen to g4, and yeah, this is a mate in 2 that follows. So you cannot really take the knight. Black had prepared this move, and he thought that this would save him. The problem is that this loses, because white just plays bishop to f6, and the problem is that if you take the knight, the queen on e2, white has a beautiful checkmate in 2. He plays his knight back to f5, giving check. White, black's king has to go to g8, and now comes the beautiful knight to h6, and this is a beautiful checkmate, one of the most beautiful checkmate pictures that you see here. And so he cannot take the queen. Potter tried to play his bishop to e7, but White just calmly plays his queen to f3, and this is completely winning, and Black resigned here. The problem is that still this mate here is threatened, and if you capture it, then White captures back, and again you have this mate, so you cannot really avoid this mate. This was a really beautiful miniature played by Stein, again showing you that you don't really have wiggle room in the Sicilian. If you play these lines, you have to be very, very alert when it comes to tactical assaults. You have to be very, very precise, because this one, this position here is equal. Okay. Let's look. I mean, this. I guess this was a critical point. Let's look at what the engine would play. Okay, the engine would prefer to take. And now let's say after this move, this looks kind of dangerous, but I guess Black has knight to g8 or something. Yeah, or even knight to e8, and this is equal. I mean, it looks a little bit strange, but this is still equal. What? Okay, this move cannot be played. Yeah, this was would have been a better continuation. I mean, yeah, White gets a little bit here from Tuchel in the center, but Black's pieces are very, very good developed, and he has counter chances, and this is an equal position. Yeah, I mean, in the Sicilian, if you survive the first 20 moves and your position is not a complete ruin, then basically you have equalized, and this game here proves it. But I think, okay, what is beautiful about chess? Blunders, especially if you are not the one who makes them. And this was just a beautiful sacrifice by Stein. And okay, I mean, here Black has no decent moves here. Okay, thank you very much, and bye bye.